All right, so this is 7C number 2 practice. So solving, finding the roots, that just means solve for x, get the solutions for x. So number one, for number one, we look to see, all of these are factorable, all the ones we're practicing here. Not all polynomials are factorable. We chose special ones here because we've been working on factoring. So looking at the first problem, always think greatest common factor right away. Is there a greatest common factor? And in this case, between the two terms, there is. They both have an x. So the greatest common factor, and it's always the smallest of the terms that would be the greatest common factor. So it's x. You have x to the third and x to the first, so it's just x to the first. What you're going to do is you're going to divide each term by x. So you're undistributing. Instead of distributing, multiplying in, you are dividing it and taking it out back out front. X to the third divided by x is x squared. 16x divided by x gets simplified. At this point, we have two different factors. Let me highlight them for you. We have x, and you have x squared minus 16. If the factor doesn't have more than one x in a term, if only one term has an x, not like you have x squared minus 16, the 16 doesn't have an x, you can actually solve at this point. So I'm going to set each factor that has an x on it, has a variable. So the x here, that's a factor. Set it equal to 0. Well, that's already a solution. Perfect. We have x squared minus 16. That's another factor, and we can set it equal to 0. You could factor that further. You can factor it into x plus 4 and x minus 4. Otherwise, you can solve if one term has a variable. You can solve. So anytime you square root, and this is solving by square roots, you have a positive and a negative. Square root of 16 is 4. So you have two solutions here. You have a positive 4 and a negative 4, and your other solution is 0. That's how you solve number one. Number two, let's look at, we have, is there a greatest common factor? And we have x to the fourth, 14x squared, 45. Well, x to the fourth has a 1, so coefficient-wise, you can't divide them all by anything except for 1, evenly, giving you an integer. X to the fourth, x squared, and 45 does an x, so no GCF. So then we don't move to anything with GCF. Then we're looking at what kind of factoring are we going to do? Well, it's a trinomial. I would go straight to A times C. So 1 times 45 is 45. I'm thinking, what two numbers multiply to 45 that add up to negative 14? And that's negative 9 and negative 5. If you can't figure that out on your own, it's okay. Just go to Desmos and you would type in, and in Desmos, you would do x times y equals 45. And you got to practice this, otherwise you're not going to remember. And definitely write it down. And x plus y equals negative 14, so that's the b. And then it's a times c on top. And you look for the intersection. The intersection is going to be at negative 9, negative 5, or negative 5, negative 9, both of them. But anyways, after you get those two numbers, you're going to put it in the Punnett square. You put the first term, the a term, in top left. Last term, C term, in the bottom right. And the negative 9, negative 5, you're going to put in the other two blanks with the x squared because they have to add up to the B term. Now, greatest common factor of the bottom row, it's going to be, you can divide both terms by 9. Since the negative 9 is negative here, we'll bring a negative out. Top row, x squared. First column, looks like an x squared again. Last column looks like a 5 with a negative because this is, the first term is negative. All right, I'm going to rewrite what we have. We have x squared minus 5 is one of our factors. X squared minus 9 is another factor. At this point, we are solving. Remember, we're solving these. We have to figure out what x can we substitute in that will make the equation 0. Well, like I said in the last problem, well, if you listened to the last problem, don't know if you did. If you're looking at a factor, if the factor only one term has a variable in it, so like the 5 doesn't have a variable, we just have x squared, you can actually set that equal to 0 and solve. So we don't have to actually see if we can break it down any further. The second factor, x squared minus 9, you can either factor that further if you'd like into x plus 3 and x minus 3 and then solve, or you can set it equal to 0 because there, the 9 doesn't have an x in it. So we solve each one of these. First, you're going to, this is reverse order of operation. So if there's addition or subtraction, you do that first. Square root. And remember, anytime you square root, there's a positive and a negative. A lot of teachers don't talk about that, but there is. So we have two solutions here. One's a positive square root of 5, and the other one is a negative square root of 5. So two solutions all written together. And the next one, we have a positive 9, so you're adding 9. And then you square root. Square root. Remember, anytime you square root, plus minus. Square root of 9 is 3. We have a positive 3 and a negative 3. So there are four solutions there, which you look at your first, your, the trinomial right away, and it's x to the fourth. That biggest exponent tells you how many solutions. You should see four. There are. All right, number three. We have four terms. Is there a greatest common factor? Nope. And then four terms. One, two, three, four. Looks like we go straight to the Punnett square. Four boxes, four terms. Try it out. First term, top left. Last term, bottom right. Other two terms, doesn't matter where they go. You can switch them around. I just switch around my usual. Greatest common factor of the bottom row is negative 1. The x is negative, so I'm bringing a negative with it. Top row, smallest of the variables or the exponents is x squared. First column looks like it's just x, which is x to the first. You can put a little 1 if you'd like. In the last column, there's nothing in common besides 1. And the x squared is positive, so we're going to bring a plus. So here are our factors. We have x plus 1 times x squared minus 1, and it equals 0. So we can actually stop right here. X plus 1 equals 0. There's only one term with an x in it. We can solve for it. X squared minus 1, you can factor that in x plus 1, x minus 1 if you'd like, or you can set it equal to 0 and solve. So the first one, super, super simple. Just subtract 1, and there's one of your solutions. Next one, we have to add first, and then we would square root. Reverse order of operations. Anytime you square root, there's a positive and negative. So square root of 1 is 1, so we have plus minus 1. Now I want to talk a little bit about this. The plus, so we have, if you were to write these three out, it'd be x equals negative 1. X equals another negative 1 from over here on the plus minus, and then x equals positive 1. So that's really what it means. On the back, you'll actually see it written as there's a solution at negative 1 and as a multiple twice. Two negative 1s, that's what that means. And then positive 1. So that's also, so looking at the solutions, you can have this as a solution. You can have this as a solution, or, and this is what you're going to probably see on the test the most. If I have it multiple choice, it's going to look like this, negative 1, mult 2. That just means there's two negative 1s. All right, number 4. Greatest common factor, yes. Looking at each term, you can divide them all by x squared. If you're undistributing x squared, you're left with x squared plus x minus 12. The x squared is a factor. That's going to stay on the outside. I see a trinomial inside here, inside the parentheses. That is a factor, but that trinomial can be broke down into, I think, into smaller factors. So trinomial, think a times c. So 1 times negative 12 is negative 12. What two numbers multiply to negative 12? That will add up to positive 1. That is 4 and negative 3. Again, you could use Desmos, do x times y equals negative 12, x plus y equals 1, and you'll come up with 4 and negative 3. We're going to use that in the Punnett square. First term, top left. Last term, bottom right, and the 4x and negative 3x. Doesn't matter which way they go. They do have to add up to the middle term, so it's got to have the x on it. Well, the greatest common factor of the bottom row, greatest greatest common factor of the top row, greatest common factor of the first column and last column. And it's negative 3 and it's a positive 4, so it's a plus 4. So let's rewrite what we have up here. So I'm going to take this, I'm going to rewrite it down here. So we have x squared. Then we're going to break it into x minus 3 and x plus 4 equals 0. So now it's broke down as much as it can. Each term or each binomial or each factor has, each term of the factors have only one variable within them. So what I'm talking about is, so we're looking at the first factor, it only has an x squared. It's the only term that's there. The second binomial, x minus 3, only the x is in the first term, the 3 doesn't have it, and the last one, again, we just have one variable in that factor. When this happens, you can actually solve for them. So you have x squared, set each factor equal to 0, and I'll talk about what each one of them means, especially this first one. So we have x squared equals 0. X squared equals 0, that small equation, x squared, that means there's two solutions. That's your biggest exponent. So it's really weird, but you have plus minus 0. There's no such thing as a plus minus 0. But this just means you're going to have two solutions at 0. Or a 0 multiple of 2. So that's what that means. There's two solutions at 0. You're going to add 3. 3 is the solution, and negative 4. So you have 4 solutions. They are at negative 4, 3, and 2 of them at 0. There are your 4 two solutions. All right, number 5. Greatest common factor? No. It is a binomial, and there's two types of binomials. You either have cubic or quadratic. And this is neither one. But I would look into quadratic first. The thing about quadratics was difference of squares, and it's really difference of squares, is can you square root both terms? Yes. The square root of x to the fourth is x squared. Square root of 16 is 4. Anytime you can do that, and there's a subtraction, which is difference. So we're looking at difference of squares. You can break this up into x squared plus 4 and x squared minus 4. You can break up that binomial into two smaller binomials. At this point, you could look, can you do that same exact thing again? Can you square root the first term? Can you square root the last term? Yes, yes, but there's a plus here, so we can't do difference of squares. The second binomial, you can. So you could break that down into x plus 2 and x minus 2. So you certainly can. Or, if you notice, both binomials only have one term with a variable in it. At that point, you can solve for it with square root, solve by square root. Sorry, totally forgot what it was called. When you square root, you always have a positive and a negative. Square root of negative 4. Well, that negative is going to come out as an I, and square root of 4 is just 2. So usually, typically we don't write it I times 2. We would write it a positive and a negative 2i. So there's two solutions there. They're both imaginary. And then the last one, we're adding 4, so no negative on this one. So square root of positive 4. Oh, don't forget the plus minus. Oh, don't do that. It's a positive and negative 2. So there's two real solutions, and then there's two imaginary solutions for number 5. And number 6. Number 6. I see a binomial, so two terms, and I see cubic. So that would tell me, can I cube root both terms? Yes, cube root of x to the third is x, cube root of 1 is 1, and this is sum. So this is sum of cubes. So we're going to factor it into your sum of cubes is a plus b, a squared, change the sign from a plus of what it was right away to a minus a times b, and it's always positive b squared. So let's substitute these in. So x, a is x, or x is a and 1 is b, so plus 1. I always put the first one in a squared in parentheses, even if it's just x. Just I get in the habit of it, so then I don't miss things when something's a little different. I don't like to do simplifying right here. And this is going to equal 0, because this is part of the factoring. We're just splitting up that x cubed plus 1 into something we can actually manage. X squared is x squared. X times 1 is x, and 1 squared is 1. All right, at this point, what we can do is we can set each factor equal to 0. The first factor, we can certainly solve for that. That's quick. Negative 1. The second one, we have two terms with variables in it. So we cannot just solve for this right now. It's not feasible. But what we can do is, you're not going to do, if you ever have to do summer difference of cubes, you're not going to do what's a times c that adds up to b. There's not going to be a factor for it. So I would use the quadratic formula. So we're going to have to use the quadratic formula here. So a is 1, b is negative 1, and c is positive 1. So the quadratic formula is opposite of b plus or minus b squared minus 4 times a times c. It's a lot of ones. My goodness. Divided by 2 times a. All right, quadratic formula, I go into the mode of substituting in first, then I start simplifying each term. So opposite of negative 1 is positive 1. Negative 1 squared is a positive 1. And 4 times 1 times 1 is 4. Over 2 times 1 is 2. This point looks pretty silly, but all I do is underneath the square root, 1 minus 4 is negative 3. And square root of negative 3. So now I'm just concentrating on square root of negative 3. Simplify that. Once you get that number down, then you simplify the square root. And the square root of negative 3 is an I. And 3 doesn't simplify at all. Over 2. Now I would look to see, can I simplify any, all my terms, my coefficients? 1, I, and 2. Nope, nothing there. So this is your final answer. There's two solutions there. You have 1 plus I squared of 3 over 2, and 1 minus I. I'm just highlighting exactly what I'm talking about. There's a plus minus, so 1 minus I squared of 3 over 2. There's two solutions there, and there's one over here at negative 1. So that would be 3 total. Looking back up, third power, that means there's 3 solutions. All right. If you have any questions on this, please ask in class.